Welcome to this concise video log on caring for a patient with fatty liver disease and newly diagnosed HIV. This program is provided by Clinical Care Options and is supported by independent educational grants from Gilead Sciences, Merck Sharp & Dohme Corp, and Vive Healthcare. This vlog was recorded by Dr. Paul Sachs. Before we begin, please note his disclosures on this slide.
This vlog is part of a comprehensive educational program on caring for aging patients with HIV. You can gain CME, CE, or CPE credit for viewing these vlogs and download the slides by visiting our website, clinicaloptions.com.
Hello, I'm Dr. Paul Sachs from Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. I just saw a patient that represents a challenging type of case that I often encounter. I'm going to go through some of the details of the patient and some of the decision-making that went into choosing the therapy. So this is a 64-year-old Black woman who was newly diagnosed with HIV. She was tested as part of an evaluation for unexplained leukopenia, and she had never been HIV tested before. She had an extensive past medical history, including hypertension, diabetes, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, stage 3 kidney disease with an estimated GFR between 30 and 59, esophageal reflux, and also she was known already to be hepatitis B and hepatitis C negative. Her initial laboratory evaluation for HIV showed that her CD4 cell count was already severely depleted at 180. Her viral load was 66,000. She had no resistance on her genotype. She tested negative for HLA B5701, and she had a low white count of 2.9. Her BMI was elevated at 31, and her glucose was slightly elevated as well as 185. And her estimated GFR was 51 with a creatinine of 1.6. Her liver function tests, her ALT was 69 and her AST was 84, both of them mildly abnormal. Now, not surprisingly, a patient like this is taking lots of medications. She was already taking amlodipine, lisinopril, metformin, simvastatin, and pantoprazole. A little bit more about her. She is a person who works full-time in a law office. She doesn't smoke cigarettes, drink alcohol, or use illicit drugs. She believes, based on her history, that she was acquired HIV from her ex-husband, and she has been divorced from him for over 10 years. And on examination, as I mentioned, her BMI was 31, and she had a palpable liver edge 2 centimeters below her costal margin. In addition, she had a 1+ lower extremity edema that she said was longstanding. So how do we come to the diagnosis of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? Well, in lots of cases, it's sort of found by chance because a lot of people are asymptomatic. Now, of course, if you ask people who have this condition, they'll frequently say they have fatigue, but fatigue is very common in clinical practice, no matter what the underlying condition is. So it's usually found with incidental LFT abnormalities, or people are undergoing imaging for some other reason, and the radiologist mentions fatty liver. Occasionally, it's found by physical examination, like the patient we have here with incidental hepatomegaly. But kind of the most common scenarios would be someone who's on a statin and is getting their LFTs monitored periodically and they have elevations, or they're followed in a diabetes clinic and they're having their chemistries measured as part of that. And on occasion, someone who is undergoing a laboratory evaluation for either medical or disability insurance. So when should you suspect non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? Well, definitely suspect it in people with abnormal LFTs who don't drink alcohol. That's a clue right there, especially if they are overweight or have underlying diabetes. You need to exclude other potential causes of liver disease, of course, and people can have more than one cause. And then if you go ahead and proceed with imaging, an ultrasound is a good start, but a really more accurate test is liver elastography. So we have a patient here who is in a high-risk group. You know, she has diabetes. She's overweight. She doesn't drink much alcohol. And her ALT, AST have a pattern that's very much consistent with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Additional evaluations the primary care clinician or the hepatologist or the ID doctor can do is to order things like hepatitis serologies and negative autoantibodies to assess for autoimmune hepatitis, as well as checking for ferritin to see if there's any evidence of hemochromatosis. Now, once you have all those things together, you can then proceed to get what I think is the most important next test, which is, after the diagnosis is maybe suggested by liver ultrasound, a elastography test, a very simple test done. Because studies have shown that if you have a bunch of these risk factors, diabetes, obesity, and high blood pressure, and you have high level of liver stiffness on elastography, then there is actually a significant possibility that the person is going to progress to develop non-alcoholic steatohepatitis and eventually even cirrhosis. And those are the highest risk patients. So why is this relevant for our elderly patient here? Well, she's going to start antiretroviral therapy. And one thing that we know is that starting antiretroviral therapy does lead to weight gain in most patients. And our current guidelines recommend that people start regimens that consist of an unboosted integrase inhibitor, such as dolutegravir or bictegravir, plus tenofovir, either allophenamide or diazoproxyl fumarate and tricitabine. So most patients are going to start that regimen. Some might start dolutegravir plus lamivudine. And recently, we've been flooded with studies that show that these regimens, especially the TAF-FTC dolutegravir, is associated with much more weight gain than other regimens. In the ADVANCE trial in particular, which is conducted in sub-Saharan Africa, they found that women showed marked increases in weight gain. At 96 weeks, they gained on average 10 kilograms if they were on the TAF-FTC plus dolutegravir arm. Now, there have been some subsequent analyses of that ADVANCE study. One I want to highlight is the looking at the comparator arm, which is the efavirenz arm. In multiple studies now, we've seen that TDF-FTC efavirenz is associated with less weight gain than comparators, especially when those comparators are integrase-based regimens. In this sub-study from the ADVANCE study, they had patients undergo cytochrome P450 2B6 genotyping, and that divided people into extensive metabolizers versus intermediate metabolizers versus slow metabolizers. The people who are slow metabolizers of efavirenz and had the highest efavirenz levels actually gained the least amount of weight. By contrast, people who were rapid metabolizers ended up gaining weight that was very similar to the dolutegravir arm. What this implies is that higher efavirenz levels may be suppressing weight, and it raises questions about whether what we're seeing in the dolutegravir and bictegravir studies with weight gain is a toxicity signal of those drugs, or alternatively, the absence of the weight suppressant effect of efavirenz. So let's go back to this case. She started on a regimen of bictegravir FTC TAF as initial therapy. I must say I did consider treating with dolutegravir lamivudine, but there are fewer data now so far on use of that regimen in people who have CD4 cell counts less than 200. She was counseled about possible weight gain as a complication or as a consequence of initiating antiretroviral therapy, and that she needed to watch for that. And she was also referred to a hepatologist for consideration of further imaging, in particular MRI, and also to consider participation in one of the many clinical trials for treatment of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So the take-home message from this case is that the guidelines thus far do not recommend any change in the primary recommended regimens based on this emerging data about weight gain, even in people with complications such as non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So they don't say to avoid integrase inhibitors or tenofovir allophenamide. These are still potential options. And so I would say the most important thing is for us to notify our patients, to counsel them, and then to treat them as if they did not have these underlying problems and monitor them very closely. Thanks very much for your attention.